Procedural generation. Two words to describe endless possibility and variation. Replayability and sometimes even unique stories per playthrough. Procedural generation comes in many different forms, not only in what is generated, but how complex the generation process is. So in order to implement procedural generation in your game, you need to know two things: how random number generation, in short RNG, works, and the limits of what you want to generate. In today's video, we'll cover the basics of procedural generation. What is it based on? What methods can be used to create levels? What are important things to consider? Let's go! True randomness is not possible with current hardware, but we can simulate randomness by outputting values that seem random. Values that don't follow a recognizable pattern. A simplified view on how this works is to imagine a large table with lots of manually inserted values in a random order. A randomness table made by hand. Whenever we want to get a value from that table, we select one of the values via some complex selection behavior. So the selected value changes every time we read a value from the table. We can do that with RandI, RandF, and RandRange in Godot, depending on whether we need an integer value, a floating point value between 0 and 1, or a floating point value of a specified name. But there is another part to random number generation. Every time we start our game, we'd get the same numbers still. So on our first startup, we might get 36471. On the second startup, we'd also get 36471. That's because the first selected value is always the same, and therefore all following ones are as well. Randomize allows us to tackle this exact problem by changing the seed of the RNG. A seed, as the name implies, is a value to determine the initial setup, including the first position to look at in the randomness table. So as long as we make sure that the seed value is different on every start of the game, we have decent RNG. The randomize function ensures exactly that by choosing a value for the seed based on the clock time at which the game was started. And because it's really difficult to start the game every day at the exact same second in time, this is a good enough solution for games. Now we know how to get random values. Just call randomize at the start of a game and use RandI, RandF, or RandRange. But what if you wanted your players to be able to define a seed themselves? Kinda like what Minecraft and some roguelites do. Well, in that case, instead of randomize, you can call seed with a custom seed value as an argument. With that, we can start discussing level generation. There are many different ways to generate levels. Do you want to create rooms or outdoor areas? Large or small levels? How much randomization do you want? Etc. For this video, we'll talk about creating indoor levels. So no generation and blending between biomes and placing water for us. That's an advanced topic for another video. Instead, we'll create dungeon-like levels. To start off, we create a single room procedurally. To do that, we use a single wall sprite with a static body and collision shape and place it in the level scene. We just need to place multiple walls in a row or column to create the room's boundaries. While we don't use any random values, this is still procedural generation. After all, we create these boundaries via code. But in the next step, we can place additional wall objects inside the room randomly. The basic idea is to iterate over every possible position inside the room boundaries and to place a wall object with a certain probability. So the next question is, how do we turn a random number into a probability value? Well, we could use randf as it returns a value between 0 and 1. But personally, I like to use randi %100. The percent sign is used for the modulo operation, just like the plus sign is used for addition. I can guarantee you, you all have done modulo calculations in your life. It's just that nobody ever told you to call it that. Remember when you first had to calculate stuff like 3 divided by 2? While 1.5 is considered the right answer, in the beginning you'll likely have solved the problem as 1 with a remainder of 1. That remainder is the result of a modulo operation. So 3 modulo 2 is 1, while 4 modulo 2 is 0. So randi modulo 100 gives us an integer value between 0 and 99. If we want to place a wall object inside the room with a 25% chance, we just need to check if the result of the modulo operation is smaller than 25. And that's everything we need to do for procedural generation. Now we just have to add more variation and add limitations. A wall object can't be placed on the player's character's position, for example. Another method is to randomly walk the area defining the room. It's very easy to make long corridors with small rooms that way. The idea here is to not iterate over every possible entity position inside a room. Instead, you generate the walkable area by walking a path and use randomization to add twists and turns. We start setting floor tiles on the player character's position. From there, we use a random value and probabilities to decide to which adjacent cell we walk the level generator. On that next cell, we place another floor tile and repeat the decision making until we have reached some number of placed floor tiles. After that, we can generate the border by iterating over each placed tile with tilemap getUsed cells and checking the adjacent tiles of each floor tile. Basically, if an adjacent tile is empty, meaning it has the value of tilemap.invalidCell, we should consider placing a wall tile there. But again, depending on your game, you'll want to add certain characteristics and limitations to your level generation, which will influence the exact conditions. As you see in this example, I've switched from placing single entities to using a tilemap instead. Obviously, this is more appropriate for the generation methods I show you, as we can just use the cells to place walls and floor tiles. The game will have better performance at runtime, a tilemap is easier to manage and therefore, to some extent, even less work. So why did I bother to show you the placement of single objects first? Because that's what you'll likely use if you want to spawn dynamic entities in your level, like items and enemies. After all, a game level is much more than just its walkable areas and boundaries. There are two more methods of generating levels in this video: merging rooms and pseudo-procedural generation. Merging rooms is, as the name implies, based on creating multiple rooms next to each other and just modifying overlapping boundaries. So if two walls of different rooms overlap, we simply place a floor tile on that cell instead. This method leads to a very different result than the random walk method. The level becomes much more spacious. So if this is what you want to generate, consider some variation of merging rooms. Last but not least, my favorite method, pseudo-procedural generation. Instead of creating each room procedurally, we only connect the rooms procedurally. The rooms themselves are handcrafted. That's what many roguelites do. It allows to clearly define the room's role in the big picture. Is it a healing room, an item room, a shop, a room with easy enemy encounters, or a boss room? By knowing this beforehand, you're able to place these rooms in a procedural way, based on how challenging you want the player experience to be for the whole level. This method is, at its core, just a variation on the merging rooms method. Instead of creating these rooms procedurally, we have specific Godot scenes for each room and load the right one into memory. You could just add them as child nodes to the main scene, but you don't need to. You can just analyze the loaded room scene and rebuild it inside your main tile map of your main scene. While this makes the level generation a bit more complicated and takes more time, everything else in the game will be much simpler. You just have one tile map instead of multiple child tile maps in the game, for example. So you don't need to figure out how to track movement of the player character across multiple tile maps. In this example, I wanted to avoid having spacious rooms. So instead of turning border wall tiles to floor tiles, I made sure that every room has the entrance on the same tile. That way, the level generator can easily line up the rooms horizontally. The right border of room A shares the same cells as the left border of room B. And because each room has an entrance on the left border, there's always a way to the next room. Of course, if you want to also expand the levels in the Y direction, you will need to implement a more sophisticated solution. There are many ways to generate procedural levels with vastly different results. So showing you one method in detail seemed like the wrong approach here, as it might not help you to create the kind of levels you want. Instead, I wanted to introduce you to different ways of thinking about level generation. By doing that, you are able to come up with solutions for your specific level generation problems. And as a word of advice, start with a very simple implementation, by having clearly defined limitations, such as room size, entry points, overall shape of the level. Only add complexity to the level generation algorithm if your game design demands it. If you still want step-by-step examples for the methods I've shown, you can buy the complete source code on itch.io and use it as a base for your level generator. You can even use it for commercial games if you want. By doing that, you'd also directly support what I'm doing here on YouTube. Link is in the description. That's it for this video. Feel free to give feedback in the comments section. And until next time, bye bye.